Yeah, welcome everybody to this week's Optical Sciences Colloquium. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce today's speaker, Professor Hui Deng. I actually have seen her give talks at various international conferences, and I always thought that the research she's doing in her group is very interesting and innovative, and it's always kind of on the border between semiconductor design and basic quantum physics. And so I'm glad that it worked out that she can give the colloquium this week. Professor Deng originally got her Ph.D. from Stanford University, and incidentally, she comes from the same group there as our own Stanley Powell. And, well, he's not here today because he had to go to serve on an NSF panel in Washington. I bet he would much rather be here to listen to the colloquium. So after her PhD at Stanford, she moved on to be a postdoc at Caltech, and then later on became a professor at the University of Michigan. Professor Deng has a number of rewards, notably the NSF Career Award, which is very prestigious, the not less prestigious AFOSR Young Investigator Award, and also the Elizabeth Crosby Research Award at the University of Michigan. welcome Hui, and the stage is all yours.
Thanks, Rob, for the kind introduction. It's my great pleasure to be here at one of the centers of optical research, and I'm glad I have the chance to tell you some of the subjects that have kept us intrigued and busy. Essentially, as the title says, we're looking for quantum phenomena, looking to create quantum systems. So the first question I guess one would ask is where do we look for quantum? Where does quantum mechanical effects show up that we can study it and control it and manipulate it? So perhaps one of the first person to conceive the concepts of quantum is Niels Bohr. In his model of hydrogen atoms, he proposed the electrons in the atom occupy discrete energy levels, and that discreteness reflects the quantum nature of the hydrogen atom, and that in turn is reflected in the discrete emission absorption spectrum when the electrons make a transition between those discrete energy levels. So the discreteness perhaps affects, in a sense, the quantum or the particle aspects of a system. Well, the other very important aspects of quantum system is the wave property of a quantum particle, such as in the interference measurement. And more remarkably is the same interference measurement performed for a system typically conceived as particles. And this double slit for electrons was once voted one of the most beautiful experiments in physics. At short exposure times, we can see the electrons, individual electron sparks at very well localized position, but random positions, reflecting its particle property, while after a long time, the interference fringes typical for a wave shows up. So there has a long paper trail and corresponding recognition by Nobel Prizes to understand the wave-particle duality of quantum systems. And perhaps one of the most notable person that contributes to the understanding of quantum is de Broglie, who was awarded Nobel Prize in 1929 for his work on the de Broglie wavelengths. And the work is interesting and important because that's the work that defined the length scale for quantum, that where we should look for quantum phenomena. The de Broglie wavelength is essentially h over p. P is the momentum of a particle. That basically says the wave property of the system will show up if we try to confine or probe the system on the length scale given by this de Broglie wavelength. So how tight can you confine a wave to the wavelength scale? If you create a potential to that scale, you cannot describe as particle anymore, and wave-particle duality will show up for the system. And very much equivalent description of that, if you take the P over here, that's our delta x, how tight you can confine it, and that's your momentum uncertainty, and that's bounded by on the scale of h, and that's the famous Heisenberg uncertainty for in quantum systems. So if we take it, if we take a particle in a thermal gas with average kinetic energy of kBT, it has this much momentum average, where the m is the mass of the particle, and the de Broglie wavelength is given by that. So we can look at how big this de Broglie wavelength is for a typical particle. For example, for a nitrogen molecule in air, the most abundant molecule in air, at room temperature, we plug in the numbers, it is 1 angstrom. It's 1/10 of a nanometer. It's even shorter than the lattice spacing between atoms in a crystal. So we simply cannot make such a small structure to confine nitrogen atom in the lab. So how can we ever get there? We can try to increase the thermal de Broglie wavelength, for example, by decreasing the temperature. So there have been tremendous amount of ingenious work to try to cool down the atoms and molecules, and again recognized by a lot of awards, including many Nobel Prizes from laser cooling to atom BEC to most recently the Nobel Prize in 2012 to Professor Hirsch and Wynand for their groundbreaking experimental methods that enable measuring and manipulation of individual quantum systems. So the effort they have, which basically is to trap, measure and manipulate single Rydberg atoms and single trapped ions. And the effort they have paid was ingenious and heroic, and it remains extremely challenging to perform these tasks even today. But alternatively, we can also find a system where the mass is much smaller to increase the de Broglie wavelength, such as quasi-particles in solids. So if we take a typical valence band electron in solids, the effective mass of the electron is a fraction of the free electron mass, which is 4 orders of magnitude lighter than the atomic mass. Then that gives us a thermal de Broglie wavelength of 10 nanometers. So that becomes a length scale that's readily accessible by modern nanofabrication technologies. As shown in this example here, each of this small blob of island is an indium arsenide island of 10 nanometers in size on top of a gallium arsenide substrate. And each of these islands will confine the excitations in it to its thermal de Broglie wavelength, then scale, and behave quantum. So the excitation will behave like a quantum particle. And those are the quantum dots, and it's one of the systems that we focus on. But you can also see here, all these islands sort of have slightly different shapes, slightly different sizes, and happen at random locations. So despite the tremendous progress in creating and manipulating and using single individual quantum systems, to create multiple quantum systems to cover them together remains a grand challenge for both atomic systems as well as solid-state systems. And that's one of the main motivations behind our work, and we look at two types of systems to look for quantum phenomena or create quantum systems. One is the quantum dot system, which is an individual quantum system, but we aim to create it in a scalable fashion. And the other one is a system that's already microscopically big, but still manifested quantum. That's the polariton condensates in the designable microcavity. So I will first talk about the first system, the quantum dots that we work with. So what is a quantum dot? Oh, I came from Ann Arbor, so that's a small joke. it's also called artificial atoms. If we think of our hydrogen atoms, the discreteness of it comes from the quantumness comes from discrete energy levels, the discrete transition energies reflecting the discrete spectrum. Now, if we consider a solid, it has 10 to 23 or more atoms, electrons in it. There's no way we can track them and study the quantum effect. But people, again, are engineers. They have figured out how to describe the system and get away with all the complexity. they take the ground state, crystal ground state of the system with a filled valence band, an empty conduction band at a very low temperature, such as T equals zero, and we take that as our ground state, our virtual atom compared to the actual atom for hydrogen atom. Then we focus on the low energy excitations from this crystal ground state as excitations from our virtual vacuum. So the lowest level electronic excitation is basically taking one electron from the valence band up to the conduction band. It will leave an empty slot here, but we want to keep our ground state, so we fill it in with the electron and a positive charge with the opposite energy and momentum. Then we can keep our ground state as if it's untouched. Instead, consider we create an electron-hole pair. And they are positive and negative charges, just like the nuclei and the electron and the hydrogen atom. So they were bound by a Coulomb interaction from a bound state, which we call the excitons. And that forms the lowest energy excitation of our semiconductor system. And this is the exciton state. The transition energy would be the band gap energy of the semiconductor minus the binding energy of the exciton. So all is good if it's in bulk. We can create another exciton, et cetera, except they are not quantum mechanical particles if they're dilute and unconfined. However, if we put this piece of semiconductor into a confinement potential, such as the quantum dot, on the size of the Dobori wavelength of the excitons, now they will feel the potential, the energy will shift a little. Now if we try to put another pair, they're so close to the original pair, they will feel strongly the interactions with each other. So the energy it takes to create the second pair will be slightly different from that for creating the first pair. And so on, if we create the third pair, the energy will still be different. So the transition between these levels, again, will correspond to different energies and give us discrete energy spectrum, just like what we get in the hydrogen atom. So that's how it will behave like artificial atom. So why do we want to create those artificial atoms, besides for curiosity to see if we can make them? It turns out this very discrete energy spectrum has something even more fundamentally quantum in it, in addition to the discreteness. Now they're discrete, so you can imagine we place a spectral filter to select only one transition energy and look at the photon at that energy. And it turns out the photon coming out are exactly one and at most one all the time. It gives us so-called a single photon source. The reason is that we can only have exactly one pair that recombine to give out exactly one photon. If you have more, it will go to a different energy and it will be filtered out. So that's just to make a distinction with a typical classical light. When we talk about a single photon, we're talking about a photon as quantized energies, quantized entities with the exact number of one that's not divisible and multiplying integers. If we take a coherent state, such as from this laser pointer, we can attenuate it to get an average intensity of one photon per measurement time. But that doesn't change the statistics of this photon. We'll still have a probability of having two photons, three photons, four photons, or zero photon. In some cases, when we make the measurement, it's only on average we have one photon per pulse. But in case of the single photon source, it's always exactly one. And that photon statistics reflecting the particle property of the photon is described quantitatively by the second order coherence function, which was first developed by Arbor in the 60s, for which he was also awarded the Nobel Prize. For thermal light, it would, or like the black body radiation, it gives a G2 of 2 with a large intensity fluctuation. For coherent state, it sits right at the boundary of quantum and classical of G2 of 1. And there's no classical light that would give a G2 of less than 1 until we describe them in terms of quantized fields. With two photons, we have 0.5, and with single photon, it's exactly 0, means there's no intensity fluctuation, always exactly one photon a time. So the single photon state is pure quantum mechanical state with no classical analog, and it also turns out to be an extremely useful state. For example, we can use the single photon to perform perfectly secure quantum communication. You can think of using this to send information. If someone tries to eavesdrop, it cannot divide it. It either takes it or not taking it. That gives us a way to detect any eavesdropping and ensure security in the communication. And quantum computing is another grand challenge that people have been working on. And in 2001, these three gentlemen has proposed a groundbreaking scheme to perform quantum computing using completely classical linear optical components that you can easily buy and build in your lab. So where's the quantumness come from? It all comes from the source. To perform this simple quantum computer computing, we need high-quality single photons as the source, as the input into the quantum computer, and that gave us the quantumness for this one. We can also use it as a perfectly random number generation, etc. And in addition to all the applications in quantum information science, if we confine a single charge in the quantum dot, we can perform spin qubit quantum computing. Or we can make a better classical device, such as quantum dot laser, with a high efficiency and no threshold. It also gave us a platform to study basic cavity quantum electrodynamics in a single atom regime, such as the strong coupling, including the work down here in Galina's group. So given all this interest and applications of quantum dots, there has been tremendous efforts to develop quantum dot systems. To date, most of the efforts have focused on self-assembled 3 arsenide quantum dots, like those ones shown here. They have very high optical qualities for each individual dot, but they have a few main drawbacks. First of all, they are self-assembled, so they form at random locations with relatively large inhomogeneity in the structural properties and optical properties. Secondly, there are 3 arsenide materials with relatively small band gaps and exciton binding energies, so that limits the quantum effects to relatively low temperatures, such as cryogenic temperatures. To get around of this, there have been a lot of development in 2 directions. One is to increase the scalability and to increase the operation temperature. To increase the scalability, people created site-controlled quantum dots, such as using oxide apertures or pyramid structures with the quantum dots at the tip. The aperture and the base of the pyramid can be defined at pre-chosen positions. To increase the temperature, we have to look at alternative materials, such as wide bandgap semiconductors and organics, like gallium selenide and gallium nitride. And more recently, people have combined these two to create wide bandgap site-controlled quantum dots. And the most favorable choice is 3 nitride, because 3 nitride is perhaps the only wide bandgap material with established technologies for electrical pumping. It has a very broad industrial base to support the development to create such as blue LEDs and blue lasers. And you probably know the Nobel Prize this last year was given to inventors of blue LEDs. So there have been 3 approaches to create site-controlled 3 nitride quantum dots. These 2 are essentially bottom-up approach, similar to those pyramids with 3 arsenide, where the quantum dot is formed at the very tip of the pyramid. What we work on is a top-down approach, where we create the quantum dots inside a tiny pillar through etching. So how do we create our site-controlled dots? This is through a collaboration with my colleague PC Koo in the electrical engineering department. We basically can take a single quantum wall wafer, which we actually can buy from a commercial company, and we define the position and the size and shape of our quantum dots through e-beam lithography and simply etch away the material by plasma etching and lift off the mask. And that gives us a very small disk in this pillar. That gives us our quantum dot. And the size of this is, again, tens of nanometers. If necessary, we can also do an anisotropic wet etching to turn the cone-shaped pillar into a cylindrical pillar. Then we can place the quantum dot anywhere inside the pillar. So by way of fabrication, you can see that we have very high degree of control of our quantum dot. We can control the position and the size and the shape to nanometer precision. We can control the thickness limited by the fabrication technology to a couple monolayers. And we can make them very compact, very closely to each other, tens of nanometers larger, and we can also create different sizes, shapes, and different spacing of quantum dots right next to each other on a small chip. In contrast, in this other two bottom-up approach, each of these structures are sitting on top of a much bigger structure that limits the compactness as well as integration of these systems. So it all sounds good, but maybe it's too good to be true. How can you have all the controllability without any sacrifice? So there is a catch, which is the very large exposed surface, etched surface, surrounding the volume of the quantum dots. So it turns out this brute force way of creating the quantum dot was tried with 3 arsenide material and very much failed exactly because of the surface effects that kills all the optical yield in the quantum dots. So the question is, well, whether or not this approach can work for 3 nitride. And since I'm here, of course it worked. So we did see single photon emission from the in-gang-gang quantum dots created with this top-down approach up to 90 Kelvin. That's the highest temperature for in-gang quantum dots in the gallium nitride barrier, including self-assembled ones. And due to some peculiar properties of the 3 nitride material, we actually, when we etch it into a small dot, we get 100 times enhancement of the oscillator strength or the interaction strength between the excitons and the photons, and it made a much better emitter compared to a quantum well. And with the systematic control we have, we can also study the correlation between optical property and the structural property systematically and accumulate statistics as well. With that, we can clarify what is the underlying reason, mechanisms the dots worked so well and worked in this way. So we have after we have established the single quantum dot made in this approach, we can also look at the scalability and the integration capability of the system. We can control the uniformity of the quantum dot as well as the energy polarization due to its strain properties. And another important ingredient is to electrically drive the single photon sources to enable on-chip integration without requiring an additional laser source. And we're also looking at integration with the plasmonic and the photonic structures. So for today, I will mainly focus on these two subjects to show we indeed have a quantum dot created this way, and we can pump it electrically to enable integration. So to see whether or not those structures can work, we have to measure its properties. And these are the two gentlemen who did all the work on that. They built this confocal setup where they can image the emission into a confocal plan. Then they can use a spatial filter to select which dots and how many dots they want to look at. And then they map the emission into a CCD monitoring camera, spectrometer, as well as all the measurement devices. Everything's ready, they turn off the light, they disappear, and the images show up on the CCD. This is the example of the photolessons from the array of quantum dots when we remove any apertures. If we flip in a small pinhole, we can select a single dot from the array. And how does the spectrum of this single dot look like? This is the example of the single dot photolessons versus the excitation power. It shows a fairly nice sharp peak that doesn't really move with the excitation power. And at high excitation powers, additional peaks show up. These are the bi-excitons and the higher energy excitations. In comparison, the quantum wells or the unedged quantum wells have a much broader peak and many, many optical phonon sidebands and a strong shift with the excitation power due to a strong stock effect due to the piezoelectricity of the system. And we can look at the intensity versus the excitation power, which is linear for the quantum dot exciton emission and quadratic for the bi-exciton emission, as one would expect for typical quantum dots. But to really show it's a single quantum dot, we have to look at whether or not it's a single photon emitter, like in the atom. So we need to measure the second order coherence function, which we can do with a Humphrey-Brown twice type of interferometer. We send in the emission into a 50-50 beam splitter and look at the coincident count of the two photodetectors behind each of the ports. So if it's a true single photon source, the single photons are not divisible anymore. It can go either this way or this way, but never both at the same time. So there will never be any coincidence counts after the beam splitter. So that's how we can measure the G2. And since the two-photon G2 is 0.5, the empirical criteria is below 0.5 for a single-photon source. And indeed, we have single-photon source from 10K up to 90K, while below 0.5 for the G2 function. So that's also the highest temperature for InGaN quantum dots in gallium nitride barrier. So how does it work? Why does this etched dot work so well for 3 nitride? It turns out it's related to the material properties of 3 nitride. I will not go into the detail, but basically it's a material with high polarity as well as piezo electricity. So due to the strain, the electron holes are pulled apart into the inside the quantum well layer, which actually caused a lot of undesirable effects, such as the strong spectral shift, reduced oscillator strength, lower quantum yield, etc. But when we add the quantum well into a dot and create the free surface, the strain is completely relaxed at the free surface, and the electric field is also removed. But inside the middle of the quantum dot, there's still residue strain and a residue stock effect. The net effect is creating a lateral confinement potential for the excitons inside the pillar, which protect it from the surface. And that's the part of the reason. And also, 3 nitride has a much smaller surface recombination velocity to begin with compared to 3 austenite. It's a couple orders of magnitude lower. So that made the very simple and highly controlled method work fairly well for the 3 nitride material. So now that we do have a single photon source created in the scalable way, but to have scalability integration, we need more than position control. We need, and the property control. We also need to have uniformity, which we have confirmed is basically limited by our control over the size. In addition, we would need electrical pumping capability to enable us to integrate on the chip. And turns out electrical pumping, which we'll focus on, has been very hard for side-controlled system. For example, if you look at these two types of systems, the dot in both of cases are formed at the tip of the pyramid under a very extended wetting layer, which is effectively a very thin quantum well layer. So even if you create a p-n junction across the dot, we apply voltage, most of the current would go through this extended wetting layer. Maybe only a very tiny fraction, if any, would go through the quantum dot region. So it's very hard to achieve any injection efficiency in those structures. And luckily, in our structure is already optimized for electrical injection for the current path. Because when you apply a voltage on top and bottom, all the current has to go through the quantum dot region. So Lei went into work to create such a single photon diode with the PN doping and the PN contacts on top and the bottom. Then he applied the voltage, and we get the nice typical IV curve for a diode structure. So is this really a diode through the quantum dot junction? We need to look at the emission. We indeed see a fairly typical quantum dot emission spectrum and a second-order correlation function well below 0.5, 0.34, or if we correct for the photon counter dark current of 0.23. So that's the first 3 nitride single photon source with both nano positioning and the capability to inject, to turn on and off this nano emitter individually on the chip. So with that, and combined with other capabilities to control the size and the shape and the polarization, it actually can open up a host of opportunities to use those nano-positioned, electrically controlled systems, such as the efficient single photon source for quantum key distribution with a polarized output, or we can utilize the nanometer resolution of the emitter itself to perform sub-wavelength imaging, or we can create, on the more classical side, a monolithic multicolor LED where we change basically the color by changing the size of our nanopillar. So this is with the individual quantum dots. If we want to create multiple systems, we can do this type of integrated scalable systems. The integration in this way, or scalability in this way, is actually classical. More interesting from the physics perspective is when we put these two dots next to each other, can we still treat them as individual quantum systems, or will they start to talk to each other? If we apply our criterion of thermal de Broglie wavelengths, the separation will still typically be much larger than the de Broglie wavelengths, and they wouldn't interact directly, such as through Coulomb interaction. However, each of these quantum dots is also an optical oscillator that couples to light. And the light it couples to has a wavelength of a micron or half a micron, which could easily become much larger than the spacing between the quantum dots we can get to. And in that limit, they actually will couple to each other through this light field. And in that case, it will manifest as a shift in the resonance energy from that of the original individual dots, as well as a change of the decay rate. And that was the phenomenon first proposed in the seminal paper by Dickey in 1954. He named it super readings in the limit of a larger ensemble of atoms placed within much smaller than a wavelength size. And he observed that, in theory, that the decay rate of this collectively coupled atomic ensemble will increase with the atomic number, where n is the atomic number, rather than keeping the original decay rate. And the intensity will increase nonlinearly as n squared with the number of atoms in the ensemble. And later on, Lemberg has generalized the model to arbitrary atom-atom separations. And there's a huge paper trail following this work to study the cooperative effects among emitters. But most of them are theoretical. It's extremely difficult to do it in 3D with atomic systems in free space. And probably there's still no conclusive evidence of super readings in that case. One of the conclusive experimental evidence happened fairly recently, but that's going to 1D with the superconducting qubits coupled through microwave fields. It's hard in 3D because the effect basically goes away on the wavelength scale. But in 1D, it actually persists to arbitrarily long distances. And that also motivated us to look into the dimensional dependence of such cooperative effect. So Taylor has developed a general solution for such cooperative emission for arbitrary dimensions, arbitrary real dimensions. And we're looking at whether or not we could use our quantum dot system to test such a theory and probe some of the phenomena. But one of the biggest challenges of doing it for both atomic systems and particularly for solid-state systems is the inhomogeneity or the differences between those artificial atoms. This is basically the level shift of the emitters due to the coupling, and this is the decay rate change of the emitters due to the coupling, and both of them are scaled to the inhomogeneous line width of the emitters. So in order to have significant effects of those cooperative coupling, we would need the inhomogeneity among the emitters to be comparable to the homogeneous line width of those emitters. And in most solids, actually all the artificial atom systems, including all sorts of quantum dots, as well as defects such as the NV centers, that difference is actually 3 to 4 orders of magnitude. The inhomogeneous line width is 1,000 times bigger than the homogeneous line width. after all, they are not true indistinguishable atoms. So to overcome that will be very challenging using optical method. Alternatively, and the inhomogeneous language is almost hitting the fundamental limit because we have such a small volume to create the artificial atom, just the atomic number fluctuation will give us a larger fluctuation in the energy, in the resonance of the quantum dots. Alternatively, we can try to increase the homogeneous language of our artificial atoms by greatly enhance the local field, such as through plasmonic coupling. So we will look at it in a simple theoretical model with an emitter based in a cylindrical wire coated by a metal shell. And we can tweak the parameters to indeed achieve more than 1,000-fold of enhancement of the radioactive decay rate. And if we can realize that in the real system, we would have a new platform to probe the coupling effect among few emitters, which hasn't been possible in the optical regime, and look at various interesting phenomena that has been proposed theoretically. So single is okay. Field body quantum systems is actually the most challenging. But the cooperative effect, if it increases with the number of emitters involved, given the same inhomogeneity, we can just increase the number of emitters to get a stronger cooperative effect. So if we don't worry about a field body, we just go to the many-body regime, why don't we just pack as many quantum dots as possible within our wavelengths? And the largest number of quantum dots we can pack is basically place them right next to each other. Then when we do that, what should we get? We get back our quantum well. And indeed, in the quantum well, the light is collectively coupled to all the excitations. So the oscillator strength in the quantum well, or the coupling exciton-photon coupling strength in the quantum well, is indeed a few orders of magnitude higher than that of individual quantum dots. But the bad news is that excitons in the quantum well are no longer confined laterally. So again, they will start to behave actually like a classical particles, except with a large oscillator strength, and we lost our quantumness. So how do we get it back? We need to confine it to the thermal Doppler wavelength scale, such as by nanostructure confinement potential, such as in the quantum dot. But we have already gone there. That's what we just did to get individual quantum systems. Alternatively, we can create a confinement potential at that scale using the excitons themselves. If we pack the excitons to the spacing of the thermal Doppler wavelength, they will feel each other's interactions and become quantum mechanically. And in that limit, the dense gas of excitons can spontaneously form a microscopic-sized quantum system. And that's, maybe we can make a classical analogy for that. If we have a large number of identical particles under special conditions, they would all want to condense into the ground state. So as specular as that is, even more specular, perhaps more useful, is when that happens in the quantum world. The most classical example is perhaps a laser, where a large number of photons would occupy a single state, so they can travel over very long distances without decay or decoherence. But more interesting is to do it with matter systems with strong interactions, such as in superfluids, superconductors, or atomic BECs. But what we're working on is actually a combined system of light and matter, or the so-called strongly coupled system, the polariton condensates. So with that, I will go to the second part of my talk of a microscopic quantum system, polariton condensates in designable microcavities. So why are we interested in polaritons? So why won't you create this light-matter coupled system? So if we go back to our quantum well, to reach that regime, we need to have the particle spacing on that order, which is the scale of a quantum dot. And it turns out, on that scale, the exciton-exciton cooling interaction will be strong enough to create a strong dielectric screening and a dissociation of the excitons instead of giving us a microscopic quantum state. Moreover, there are unavoidable defects in the quantum wells, typically on that scale as well, which will cause localization of the and destroy the coherence in the quantum state. So we need to make that larger, as well as make the system insensitive to defects to that scale. So to do both, we would need to somehow greatly increase our thermal Doppler wavelength. How can we do that? We can decrease temperature, but then it quickly becomes impossible or very impractical. Or we can decrease the effective mass. So what has the lightest mass in the world? Photons, that's right, it has zero rest mass. So we can couple it with photons to decrease the effective mass of our quasi-particle. And that's the polaritons created by strong coupling. So how does that work? If you take an exciton system from a virtual vacuum, we create the exciton. It can decay non-radiatively, or it can recombine and emit a photon. In the so-called weak coupling regime, this process is not reversible. So this photon will be distinguishable from that photon. However, if we increase the coupling strength between the exciton and the photon, this absorption and the emission can happen much faster than any decay or decoherence of either the exciton or the photon. The process becomes reversible. So in a sense, when we send in the excitation, we can no longer tell whether it's in the exciton or it's in the photon. Or in another word, neither the exciton nor the photon is a good eigenstate of the system. Instead, they are coupled together and form new eigenstates, which we call the polaritons, or the low and upper polaritons separated by their energy difference. And that goes into our strong coupling regime. And to achieve that regime, we need the coupling strength to be larger than both the photon decay rate and the exciton non-radiative decay rate. And in the typical semiconductor system, we achieve that by putting our quantum wells inside a high-quality cavity, which on one hand will greatly enhance the field amplitude at the quantum well to increase the coupling strength, and it will also confine the photons to decrease its decay rate. So for typical semiconductors, the coupling strength is about 10 millielectron volt, and we need a decay rate much smaller than 1 millielectron volt, or a Q factor, quality factor for the cavity of a few thousands or higher. When we reach the strong coupling regime, we create this new megamoles of polaritons, and they can be written down exactly mathematically as a linear superposition of an exciton and a photon. So the exciton part gives us a strong nonlinearity and rich many body physics we can explore, while the photon part gives us a very light effective mass, which is 5 orders of magnitude lower than the electron mass, or 8 or 9 orders of magnitude lower than the atomic mass. Moreover, the photon helps us to enforce the coherence and make it robust against local defects. In addition, when the photon couples out from the cavity because of the fixed decay rate, it maps every information of the polaritons into the photon field, including its energy, momentum, or implant momentum, as well as the statistics of the polaritons. So we can directly measure very much everything about the polaritons through the photoluminescence from the system that give us a very direct experimental access to the polariton gas inside. So with all these wonderful properties, there has been tremendous progress on the subject as well. People have seen the hallmarks of microscopic quantum states. We can confirm it reaches the quantum degeneracy of the spacing on the order of de Broglie wavelengths, measured by k-space occupancy. And we can measure its coherence functions and see a great increase of the coherence, both the first order and the second order, above the transition threshold. And many groups worldwide have also seen long-range transport, vortices, just some oscillation, etc., typically associated with a superfluid or microscopic coherent wave. So fundamental physics aside, the polariton system also naturally lends itself to applications. For one thing, with a light effective mass, quantum effect can manifest at very high critical temperatures. Also, with the built-in metallite interface, it is natural candidate for photonic applications. And it's already on the semiconductor platform, which has the potential for tunability, integration, and scalability. For example, proof of principle has demonstrated to use it as an ultra-fast switch or to use it as a laser with very low threshold. When the condensate forms, they should form a coherent state. So the light that comes out from the condensate should also be coherent, just like in the laser. But since the condensate is actually the ground state of the system, it doesn't require electronic population inversion required by conventional semiconductor laser. So we have shown the threshold at a few order of magnitude lower than the population inversion density for both low-temperature systems as well as high-temperature systems. And most recently, people have shown electrical pumping of polariton lasers. So in addition to these improved classical devices, some of the main challenges of this system is the still fairly strong mode competition in all these demonstrated polariton lasers, which led to poor coherence properties compared to conventional lasers. And also, it's still hard to find a direct manifestation of the matter wave nature in the emitted light to make a distinction with a photon laser. To overcome this, one would need to be able to confine the system, clean up the modes, and to control the properties to clarify the physics. So in addition to these improved classical devices, there has also been many proposals to create quantum devices using the coherent polariton waves, such as matter wave logical circuits, or to generate quantum lights with a coupled polariton systems, or to explore novel phases in quantum simulation with polariton lattices systems. But all these are theoretical proposals, and to implement them, again, we would need a very nicely created polariton 0D quantum boxes or 1D quantum wells. We'll need to be able to couple those different components and also single cell access or direct access to each of the cells in those coupled systems, which again requires being able to control, confine, and couple those polariton systems. So that has led to intense effort to control, confine, and couple polariton systems, which can be done through both its matter part and its light part. Through the matter part, there have been many methods developed to confine and control the excitons. Through the light part, there has been patterns created at the surface of the cavity to modulate the photon mode. But in these approaches, the biggest advantage is that they keep the excitons protected and untouched and keep the coherence properties of the system. But the biggest problem is that confinement and modulation are necessarily weak in these approaches, since excitons has a much smaller size or thermal Doppler wavelength compared to the polaritons or what you can do to the system. If we want to create a much stronger confinement on the polaritons, we need to do something drastic to the photon fields or to the cavity structure. So two of these most successful methods was to create an embedded aperture close to the cavity layer or brute force etching throughout the DBR mirrors to create a top pillar to structurally confine the system. In both cases, people have created 0D and 1D polariton systems, but in both cases, they also create, again, a free exposed surface in this 3 oscillator material that may introduce exciton loss and spurious free carriers, which will also affect the coherence properties. And both of the technologies are fairly complex and can, so far, has only been done very well by a few of the most resourceful groups in the world. So that motivated us to ask the question whether or not we can create a cavity polariton system that can enable strong network confinement, still non-destructive to the excitons, and we would also hope to be able to even control the fundamental properties of the polaritons, such as dispersion, energy density of state, group velocity, polarization, or angular momentum, etc. And of course, we would like to be able to couple those confined and controlled proton systems and integrate them with other structures. So why has it been so hard to do that? It partly comes back to the cavity structure we use. This is the cartoon picture of exciton confined in the cavity, but the real structure looks more like that. Well, we have a tiny layer of a few nanometers thick containing the quantum well excitons, sandwiched between two huge stacks of distributed Bragg reflectors, which are required to form a high-quality cavity. The thicker the stacker, the better the quality factor. And for typical high-quality cavities, we have about 20 nanometers thick each on both sides, while the middle of the quantum well is a small fraction of a nanometer. So that structure is very robust, but also very resistant to any change or control you want to make. So we decided to make a different type of cavity structure with more flexibility. And to do that, we decided to completely get rid of the top DBR and replace it with a single thin layer of slab photonic crystal. And the simplest construction is basically a grating. So the first question you would ask is, can such a very compact and single layer structure work well as a cavity mirror that we need? To do that, we have used two tricks. One is to make the period to be sub-wavelength, so we get rid of diffraction and only has reflection. Another, to utilize the very high contrast of the reflection index. To make the reflection high, we basically need strong constructive interference among the waves. And that will be effective if we have a strong index contrast between the components in the mirror, such as between the DBR pairs. But in the DBR, we need to create it in the lattice matched fashion, which limits the contrast to about 1.1 to 1.2 typically, which is very small. In this case, we have the contrast between the material and the air, which would be over 3 to 1 in 3 arsenide systems. So that turns out can give us a very high reflectance and a very broadband reflectance using even just such a simple structure. And that's the simulation of the reflectance for a DBR mirror and our high contrast grating mirror. So we can achieve the same quality factor with 1/10 of the thickness in the top mirror. And more important than that, with the grating, we now suddenly have quite a few design parameters available, such as the period, the duty cycle, the thickness of grating, as well as the air gap below. That opens up a huge design space for us to design and control the optical mode of the cavity. So of course, I need to confess, this is not my original idea. Such grating has been studied since the 80s and has been applied very successfully to classical VCSEL lasers and passive elements recently. And what we are interested in is to use this for the polariton system in the strong coupling regime. And in that regime, it will be even more powerful because once we control the photons, we directly control the polaritons in the strongly coupled system. So it all sounds great on paper, and did it work? We indeed shown that we could create strong coupling in such a system, as well as achieve polariton lasing. And we can create confinement simply by designing the size of the grating. And the grating also gives us polarization selectivity as of the ability to engineer its dispersion. And with the cleaned up system, we have looked at the single mode polariton laser again with its coherence properties, which turns out to be greatly improved. And we can create coupled structures. So I think I will mainly focus on show you that indeed the system works for polaritons and quickly go through these results. So these are the two people who worked on making the very first HCG DBR cavity work. That's the design. And the board did all the fabrication and took those nice ACM pictures showing the grating suspended on top of air gap. That's the top view of a small grating. We made the device, and we look at its optical properties. So we excited outside of the grating region. We see a flat band, flat and broad exciton emission. Now if we move the excitation inside the grating region, the exciton emission disappeared and the two branches of the polaritons appeared with a larger dispersion and discrete modes for the lower polaritons. And we can compare that dispersion to the theoretical dispersion. And but this is the energy, and that's the implant momentum, which in the picture we can acquire through Fourier space imaging directly from the photomolecence. So we can take the exciton energy measured independently from outside the grating region and take the lower and the upper polariton energies, plug into a theoretical model for the polariton dispersion, and compare with our data, that is the white line. From the fitting, we get the uncoupled photon energy as well as the coupling strength. And we can model the confinement effect by harmonic potential, and the white dashed line shows the calculated energy levels in the harmonic confinement potential. We can also do temperature tuning to verify the strong coupling for the system. So that shows we do have a strong coupling. In addition, since the grating breaks the implant symmetry, rotation symmetry, we also have a strong polarization selectivity. We have strong coupling for the TE polarization, but a low quality cavity, and as a result, weak coupling for the TM polarized modes. So the next question is to show whether or not we can still achieve the polariton lasing regime in such a cavity. So if we increase the intensity, we see the typical nonlinear threshold. And below threshold, most of the populations are distributed through all the levels. Toward the threshold, they aggregate more towards the ground state. And above the threshold, almost everything comes from the ground state. So that was the first polariton laser in such a designable cavity, and with a 3D confinement and discrete modes, and with the polarization selectivity, we removed any degeneracy in the ground state. So that's the first truly single-mode polariton laser. It turns out when we achieve a truly single-mode polariton laser, it also completely suppressed any intensity fluctuation that have always persisted in polariton lasers before. So Hung did all this measurement where he showed the second order correlation decreased very sharply at the threshold toward 1, which is the Poisson limit or the short noise limit expected of a truly coherent state. And before, it has always been limited at a much larger level than the Poisson limit. And we're able to do this because now we have a truly single mode without mode competition, and we open the energy gap between the ground state and the first excited state, and we also get rid of the polarization degeneracy. And with a truly Poisson noise limited polariton laser, we can also now probe the intrinsic phase coherence or phase noise of the polariton laser. So we measured the first order coherence function versus the occupation number in the ground state. If we fit this, it turns out the shape of the first order coherence function, which is Fourier transform of the spectral shape, changes from a Lorentzian decay, as you typically expected and always seen in the photon laser, into a Gaussian shape. And the Gaussian shape comes out not because of any spurious noise, because we maintain the G2 of 1, but it comes out because of the interactions between the polaritons in the condensate. And we can model that accurately with a analytical model based on single-mode atom lasers that's developed in the past for atomic laser, for atom BEC lasers. And the transition takes place with the total interaction strength in the condensate becomes comparable or larger than the decay rate or the coherence line width of the ground state polaritons. And we reach that regime partly also because we have very tight confinement to increase the effective interaction strength between the polaritons, and we can measure it because we completely suppressed the intensity fluctuations to the coherent limit. So In addition, we have also shown, we also did numerical work to show that with the design parameters available, we can change the angular dependence of reflection phase, which in turn enables us to change the dispersion of the polaritons compared to the very much fixed dispersion of the DBR. We can make it much deeper with a much lower effective mass. We can make it almost flat, or we can even reverse it, or we can even make a double well type of dispersion. And that may enable us to explore various other phases perhaps possible in the system. And we have also made some preliminary designs where we simply modify the boundary conditions of this grating mirror, which will create effective potentials that allow us to create a separate uncoupled 0D polariton boxes, or coupled polariton boxes, or a lattice, a quasi-1D lattice with band structures for the polaritons. So I think I'm running out of time. So to summarize, we have created a designable polariton system where we have shown we can achieve strong coupling as well as a single mode polariton lasing, and we can control its properties such as polarization selectivity, the dispersion, as well as dimensionality. And we can confine them to lower dimensions and create coupled structures or coupled lattices. So with that, I think I will conclude with a quote from Phil Anderson from a long time ago, a famous quote, "More is different." Hopefully with these few systems, we can look at both individual quantum systems, how we couple them to create few body quantum systems, up to many body macroscopic sized quantum systems, as well as a few body quantum systems where each of the body is actually a microscopic-sized quantum state. So these are all the people who actually did all the work. The five gentlemen standing on the side, on the back, did all the work shown today. Glenn is a relatively new student who joined us, and Pao did something completely different. And those are the sponsors and the Quantum Dot Works collaboration with the Coos Group, and who made all these etched quantum dots. And our MBE wafer, planar wafer for the polariton work, was provided by our collaborators from Germany. Thank you.